everyone mentions a part of her that we relate to so much and that obviously we can never forget. My name is Judith Moses. I'm the oldest of five children in the Moses family. My sister Sandra and my brother Bob, we're the three still here. Ethel Leona Moses. The world is a little less bright today. It is just like my mother to decide to leave us in the fullness of spring with all that hope and promise ahead. And I have to say, and others have said it, that it would be hard to find another woman who was more dedicated to her family and to her God. We all have our private Leona moments, and we look forward to sharing them all with you after. We have stories, and I know we'd love to hear your stories as well. We got used to, my siblings and I, sharing our mother with people from a very young age. She didn't just become like this, she was always like this. and she loved people, as has been mentioned. She was gregarious, she was curious, she loved a challenge. If there was there a challenge, she was there. But I'm sure we'd all agree on one thing, if we did share our stories, she was a veritable tour de force in this world. She had boundless energy. She had unfathomable optimism. Everything was going to work out fine. And she produced a dozen good ideas every day, how to make the world a better place. I'd get this phone call, and she had this idea, we should be doing this now. And so she was just so lively. I think she invented the term lifelong learning. She was passionate about learning, and Norm, we have boxes of books that I need to return to. She epitomized the term social justice advocate. She has been so active, both in the church and outside of the church. And as somebody mentioned to me, I think it was Wanda this past week, she was the original Energizer Bunny. And could she talk? She loved becoming a respected elder, not for her wisdom, because she took that for granted. But people stopped interrupting her and gave her free license just to talk the blue streak. I was at a church event with her not too long ago, and she was waxing eloquent, and one of the organizers came and said, "We don't feel comfortable interrupting an elder, but could you just give her a little signal?" But becoming an elder had other high points for her, and I must say she really enjoyed meeting the Queen and the Duke and the Pope, and these were lifetime highlights for her. When people saw her on TV, they saw her say something to the Queen, and the Queen smiled, and when people asked her afterwards what she said to the Queen, she just said, "I asked her about her horses." And our mother lived an active life right up to the end. Let me tell you what she did in her final days. She first of all helped Norm organize Sunday's Aboriginal Day of Prayer at the Mohawk Chapel, and she missed being there by just a few hours. She spent, as Bishop has mentioned, 2 days last week and the week before in London, Ontario, helping the Diocese of Huron sign on to this five-year partnership with an Indigenous group in the Amazonia region of Brazil. And she was passionate about their environmental and democratic issues. She's been working with Father Norm Casey and the Lutheran Church in Waterloo to establish an after-school music program here in Six Nations, and she's got me and my Grace Church in Toronto organizing an instrument drive for the children. She's worked with Norm to secure funding for a new youth suicide prevention program here in the community, and she's been helping me organize a visit from my Toronto parish, Grace Church on the Hill, to Six Nations on the 14th of June, and I wondered whether we ought to cancel that, and of course, Norm said, "No way, she would not want this canceled." She caught the Six Nations bus to the demonstration in Parliament Hill not very long ago on Indian education, and she carried a sign that said, "Stephen Harper has to go." She did some urgent research on our family tree a couple of weeks ago to help my son Sebastian get his green card under the Jay Treaty to go to LA. And the week before, she cut her almost 1 acre lawn herself. She was booked this past weekend to help out in the advance polls for the Ontario election. They called and said, where is she? We're waiting for her. And those are only the things that I'm aware of. I'm sure there are others. And as has been mentioned, she was a woman of the Christian faith. However, I have to say that her faith was sorely tested at times. Like any good Christian, she did question. And the residential schools issue weighed very heavily on her. Her sister, Eleanor, did go to the residential school. My mother was tempted many times to walk away from the church. Instead, what she did was she threw herself into the area and she worked tirelessly to help build a more open, accepting Anglican Church institution that honors its past and the victims. I'm sure she was a real thorn in the side of many in her passionate search for true disclosure and healing within the church and with the families. She believed passionately that progress could be made, and I remember how proud she was when Bishop Mark MacDonald was appointed to head the Indigenous ministry within the Anglican Church. She saw that as a true victory. She and I talked recently about progress in bridging a modern church with traditional Aboriginal ways. We talked about the sweet grass purification ceremony that we started with today. We talked about the traditional symbols, the native languages, and Norm had mentioned, we sang a lot of Mohawk at the service my mother organized. I don't speak Mohawk, so it was not easy. But she wanted those songs as hymns sung in Mohawk, and I gather she had already learned the Mohawk language. So, but my mother and I remembered that it wasn't always a fact that we felt comfortable having these symbols in the church. Some of my cousins may remember that when her dad, Grandpa Hill, died many years ago, we basically had two funerals. One was the hidden Mohawk funeral, and the other was the Christian funeral. And they did not bridge at that time. So I know that our mother struggled to bridge her traditional Native spirituality with her Christian faith. I'm sure most of you have heard some of her very strange stories and dreams. When I was a little girl and she would tell them to me, I used to say, Mommy, maybe we should not tell people about these things. But she was very factual about them. She just put it out there. And it's no secret to many of you that she predicted her own death from a dream several months ago. She set about putting her affairs in order this winter. Every time she talked about dying, I reminded her that her own mother lived to almost 100, and that I was sure she had at least another 15 years left. She talked about slowing down, but she never got around to it. So she was found in bed on Saturday in exactly the position that she dreamed, with her open book beside her. Many of you have asked me, what was she reading? Well, all I can say is, there's no light bedtime reading for my mother. She was reading Rupert Ross's 1946 book called, appropriately, Dancing with a Ghost. The book was open to a section about integrating Western science with traditional Native convictions and commandments. It talked about how these different views of the universe can coexist to respect the natural order and help the survival of humanity. Now, that's not exactly what most of us would choose to fall asleep to. Our mother started out her life as a young stay-at-home mom here on the reserve on the Moses family farm. Unfortunately, for the children, she never really mastered the woman parts of the day. In spite of a lot of coaching from the Federated Women's Institute of Ontario, cooking was not very important to her. When we moved to Fort Erie, when I was about 5 or 6, she began to work as a nurse's aide and to study nursing. Eventually, she became part of an open heart surgery team, and she became an open heart technician. And again, it was a great source of pride to her that she participated in the first heart transplant at the Buffalo General Hospital. She loved nursing, and she loved the miracle of the human body. She spoiled many an appetite at dinner as she regaled us with the stories of her surgeries that day. No one loved the look of an open heart like my mother did. been mentioned, but it was kind in a no-nonsense way. When I was maybe 13 or 14, she worked at a small community hospital, the Douglas Memorial Hospital in Fort Erie. And it's a little town, and I would sometimes go up to the hospital and follow her around on her rounds in the wards, just for something to do. So I learned a lot just from watching her, and she was very good at it. One Friday night, she was very busy, and there was an elderly man dying. She grabbed me, dragged me over, made me sit by his bed, and put his hand in mine. And with those dagger eyes, she gave me that look that said, "You just stay there, and don't you let his hand go." This man had no family, and at age 13, I learned from her the ultimate kindness and honor to help someone transition from this life to the next. Our mother was a feminist before the word was even invented. She pursued a career in studies with her 5 children and a husband. Between the parents, somehow they made it work. I had no idea that not all families shared the housework, that most fathers did not braid their daughter's hair, or that most mothers did not do their homework at the kitchen table alongside the kids. We studied our Latin together, not just for me, but to help her memorize her medical terminology. The boys took great pleasure in putting comic books inside of their textbooks so they could fool her. There was so much richness in our mother Leona's life to celebrate here today. She was such an inspiration to her children, her grandchildren, and her great-grandchildren, Hannah, Zach, and Will Carter. So I know that her friends will miss her as much, if not more, than we, and there are many of you who are, especially Norm, who were in touch with her on a day-to-day basis. And in so many ways, she hasn't really left us. I can still hear her voice whenever I do something. I can hear Grandma, Mom saying, Judy Ham. So I just can't believe that we're not going to hear that familiar, outspoken voice again, or see that bustling 5'2" mission-oriented figure doing everything that she did so efficiently and leaving all of us exhausted in her wake. And I challenge any of you to say whether you've ever seen her when she wasn't rushing around. But I know our mom's spirit is with us today. Sandra, Bobby, and I just want to say, Mom, how proud we are of you. What a wonderful, wonderful role model you have been, and how much we love you. We miss you already. The sun shines a little less brightly today.